Look, it's like piano keys. Crosswalks. That's pretty neat. Okay, so here we are at the Fullerton Museum Center. And we're going to go check out the Leo Fender exhibit. It's only up until March 17th. Hello and welcome to Scott's Adventures. Today we're at the Leo Fender exhibit at the Fullerton Museum Center. And we're going to see the history of the electric guitar and learn a lot about the man who made that happen, Leo Fender.
As a band performed at Leo Fender's Fullerton Radio Shop in 1945, using Fender's amplifiers and steel guitars, he heard a sound that it had lived in his mind for years, and that he'd struggled to achieve with his products. Leo described the bright, rich sound as a shower of brilliance. Over time, it became clear that Leo Fender's true shower of brilliance was the torrent of inventions that flowed from his mind. In his 81 years of life, he amassed over 75 patents, while the musical tools he put into players' hands changed the soundscape and cultures of planet Earth, inspiring and enabling musicians from Los Angeles to London, Chicago to the Congo, and points beyond. Some 7 decades later, Leo introduced his greatest instruments. Players are still creating new music that would have been unimaginable without his work. As the company moved into the 1950s, his solid body electric guitar and bass were slow simmering hits, and his frequently updated amplifiers were becoming standards for tone, utility, and durability. There was even a steady market for Fender's new lap steel models. However, instead of relaxing, Leo was usually at his workbench looking ahead. The main thing on his mind was coming up with a follow-up to the Telecaster. If he didn't have something new and different to entice musicians, his competition certainly would. Don Randall, the head of Fender sales, also saw that coming, and he prodded Leo to create an electric guitar that was futuristic enough to make a buzz in the industry. The Stratocaster certainly served that purpose. Soon after being issued in 1954, it turned up on bandstands, on record covers with Buddy Holly and Ritchie Valens, on TV with Lawrence Welk's guitarists, and in blues bars from LA to Chicago. When a magnet passes a coil of conductive wire, it generates an electric current. That's how the huge turbines in Hoover Dam produce electricity. It's also how a guitar pickup works. In the late 1950s and 1960s, Orange County had a varied and robust music scene. Even Disneyland hosted hootenanny nights while traveling acts playing music from blues to bluegrass, as well as local talents Jackson Browne, Tim Buckley, and others, played in venues from Buena Park to San Clemente to the Balboa Peninsula. The electric guitar has become so commonplace that a world without it is hard to imagine. For decades, its sound and textures have shaped every entertainment medium: live performances, recordings, radio, movies, and television. Scores of musicians, inventors, and manufacturers participated in the electric guitar's history. This gallery spotlights Leo Fender and his associates who created the first commercially successful solid-body electric guitars, electric bass guitars, and high-fidelity amps. Leo Fender's ability to identify and solve musicians' problems made him the most prolific and successful electric guitar inventor in history. Since its opening in 2006, the Leo Fender Gallery at the Fullerton Museum Center has drawn visitors from around the world to marvel at the inventive genius behind the world's most popular musical instruments. Rotating exhibits have focused on advertising, patent schematics, electric basses, and unique instruments and custom guitars. I love this quote by Pete Townsend. He's talking about how durable Fender guitars are. And here's a couple of pictures of him giving his guitars a workout. As I was doing research for this video, I learned about the friendly rivalry between players that played Telecasters and Stratocasters. There were a few famous people over the years that played both, but pretty much people stuck to one or the other. And they preferred those, and they kind of had a rivalry as to which one was better, but I think it all comes down to personal choice. This is a photo of when Leo was in high school. Yes, he did play musical instruments, quite a variety of them, but he had a quote which I loved, that he's better at making instruments than playing them. Boy, I can relate to that. Leo started off his electronics career in the 1940s repairing radios. Here is one of his business partners for his first shop that repaired radios before he went into making musical instruments. In 1952, Leo brought out a new product that was at least as influential as a Telecaster, the precision bass.